The holy grail of investing in equity markets is to find firms which can deliver returns on capital substantially higher than their cost of capital, and then have the ability to sustain this gap for decades in a row. We call these firms consistent compounders. And if you really see what the gap between return on capital and cost of capital really means, it is the free cash flow that a firm generates. The wider this gap, the more competition the firm attracts, and intense competition tries to narrow this gap down as much as possible over time. In the global landscape, most of the firms that dominate their sectors, they do not generate returns on capital far higher than their cost of capital. Hence, in the global landscape, consistent compounders aren't present very easily. However, India is unique. In the Indian landscape, there exist firms like Pidilite in adhesives, Asian Paints in paints, HDFC Bank in the banking sector, Nestle in packaged foods. All these firms not only dominate their respective sectors, but their returns on capital are far higher. These are the best examples of consistent compounders. In 2014, I started managing my own money and started advising my friends and family on this philosophy of investing in consistent compounders.
So everything that you heard from Rakshit so far suggests that that this is a very simple philosophy. But the challenge often in the investing profession is what is simple is often not easy. And the core challenge in this form of investing is understanding sustainable competitive advantage. A lot of people in our country struggle to understand why large dominant firms like, say, Maruti Suzuki or, say, Unilever, why they are not consistent compounders. And they find it equally hard to understand why equally large firms like Asian Paints and HDFC Bank are consistent compounders. And to figure this out, to understand the core of sustainable competitive advantage, often takes months, sometimes years of research to get to the bottom of this. That in a way is the secret of the consistent compounder sauce.
The research process typically includes understanding why companies like Asian Paints and HDFC Bank have been able to deliver a consistent historical track record of healthy fundamentals, what has been the nature of competition, disruptions, evolutionary changes that these firms faced in the past, and why was it that their moats, their competitive advantages, their returns on capital as a result, they were not competed away. For instance, a firm like Asian Paints, it has faced competition from erstwhile incumbents like Jensen Nicholson, which actually used to dominate the sector a few decades ago, Kansai Nerolac, which still competes with Asian Paints in the current landscape, world's largest paint company Sherwin-Williams, which entered India in 2006 and then exited in 2012 after finding it difficult to even cross 100 crores of revenues. Asian Paints has also seen one of its promoter families exit in 1997. And we've been through so many generations of promoters, three generations of promoters over the last 70 long years for the firm. All this happening inside and outside the firm, but nothing could shake the consistency of healthy fundamentals delivered by Asian Paints. And in order to understand the DNA of a firm like Asian Paints, amongst other things, we spend many hours, months, at times years, with ex-CEOs of paint companies in India speaking to dealers and contractors who have been in this industry for several decades. And once we understand the secret sauce of firms that are there in our coverage universe, we watch them like a hawk. And we keep our ears close to the ground to ensure that we remain focused on the sustenance of the firm's competitive advantages over time?
So several years ago, a friend of mine who's also a fund manager recommended that I read Robert Kirby's 1984 paper. And it was a real eye-opener. Robert Kirby, who's a fund manager at Capital, a celebrated fund manager at Capital in Los Angeles, in fact, he lays out a very simple philosophy. He says, find great companies and then hold them for 10 years. Don't try to time the exit. Don't try to time the entry. Simply buy great companies and sit tight for a decade. It's basically like going to an ATM machine, which is spewing out 2,000 rupee notes and just standing there and collecting the cash, not trying to figure out when to move away from the ATM machine. I found that philosophy very interesting. I implemented it in my personal life, in my portfolio. It yielded good results. And that led me to ask the question, you know, is there a book here? Is there a method here that we could lay out in a book for investors out there in the real world? And after meeting some of the companies who could potentially be part of the book, companies like Berger Paints, like Marico, we realized that the core of these great compounders is sustainable competitive advantage combined with a promoter, with a management team, which is unusual in its focus on competitive advantages, unusual in its focus on high quality governance, unusual in its focus of creating a compounding machine which sustains over several decades. And that's where the title of the book and the core insights in the book, Unusual Billionaires, came about. We took Bob Kirby's work, brought it to India in the Unusual Billionaires.
The only sustainable way is to make it some kind of an institution so that there is continuity and the family can, in a way, reap the benefits of dividends, etc. So therefore, we decided that it's better to take a chance. It may be better run professionally than our own coming there, or it may be worse, right. But this is a price to pay for sustainability. So it was not a choice, to tell you the truth, in our minds.
Very interesting.
First of all, we carried on working in the way instinctively we felt it should be the right way to do things. We had no clue how others were operating. So when the book, Unusual Billionaires came about, then we read about others also. And we also realized, we also had no clue that in the filter, which is the excellent filter that you made, that we would actually be in the top 6 or 7 in the whole of India. It quite surprised us because we knew what was happening with us, but we had no idea how it was in comparison to others. So that was very, very surprising for us and very encouraging and very inspiring. And secondly, what we did was what we did instinctively, and we felt strongly that this is the right way to do it for sustainability, for making a nice company. What I liked about the book was when I read about the other companies in the Unusual Billionaires. I learned a lot from that. I must give you credit that I learned a lot from the history, the progression and the pattern the others followed. So it was a learning for me. It's one of the nicest books I've read.
So I think the key thing is for any entrepreneur is to identify at what stage the business is. And it's important that the role of entrepreneur shifts as the business grows. So when you are small, you are doing things yourself because you cannot afford to recruit. And forget about afford, but you cannot just recruit because good quality talent will not come in. But as you grow, you have to recruit talent. And I think that's where the role shifts from doing things to getting things done. And that's a huge shift, and most entrepreneurs don't realize what that means, because it means that you have to recruit very good talent, you have to empower people, you have to ensure that they work with each other, so team building, processes, all that comes in. And I think then it is the time for the entrepreneur to sit back a little bit and see how can he make others perform better. So I think every organization has to have a very strong succession plan at all levels. and especially at the top level. And as I started getting older, I mean, that question was raised by my board, what is my succession plan? Normally in Indian family-owned organizations, it is assumed that the children will take over. In my case, what happened was I have a person who has worked with me for 10, 12 years. We had a discussion with at a board level and we decided to promote him and I decided to step down. What I call hands off, but mind is always on. So day-to-day basis, nothing comes to me for decisions, but I'm actively involved in terms of what's happening in the organization and I add value in terms of whatever thoughts I have. So it's been a win-win kind of a arrangement, and I'm also enjoying this role, which has been a big shift for me from a full-time managing director role to spending just 20% of my time on the company. And if you look at our portfolio of products, in whatever product we are present in, we are market leaders in that particular segment. That's one. Number two, as modernization comes in and as youth is getting exposed to the Western world, we are seeing that they are buying newer products for what we call pre and post wash hair care. We've gone to hair gels and hair creams and hair fixes and hair waxes for the modern youth who wants to go to a discotheque, you know. But you're right, we need to now go beyond hair oils. As an organization, you always have to look at what are the newer opportunities. So we have gone into now Saffola Foods, where we have launched a whole range of, apart from after the oats, which is doing very well. Within 3-4 years, we built a 100 crore plus franchise in masala oats. We are going into other high protein soups. We already have launched high protein soups. Green tea, green coffee with variants.
So after quitting my previous role in 2018, I decided to put my skin in the game fully. I decided to found Marcellus Investment Managers. The goal of the firm was and remains to manage money for individuals and for corporates using the precepts laid down by Robert Kirby in his celebrated 1984 paper. We call this approach the Consistent Compounder PMS. And beyond the intellectual element of investing, beyond putting high quality research into play, we've also focused on hiring the best talent in India and setting up systems and processes so that the overall client experience we can provide is world class. So Consistent Compounder PMS is not just implementing high quality intellectual approaches, but also making sure that the end-to-end investor experience is more than satisfactory.
I used to work in Mumbai with a very prominent brokerage. From there, I joined one of the largest family offices in India. As part of a very small investment team, I was responsible for investing $2.5 billion and consistently generating returns. When I heard that Marcellus was being set up, I reached out to Saurabh because I wanted to be part of a team where, you know, they take the ideas of fundamentally high quality long-term investing to a wider range of people. I met the Marcellus team 3 times over long chats and I signed up.
Besides delivering healthy investment returns to our clients, we focus a lot on client service. We intend to deliver the highest level of transparency when it comes to delivering portfolio management services. At the outset, we spend a lot of time with our clients explaining the investment philosophy so that their journey through with us is smooth. Secondly, we've hired one of the best back-end service providers from custodians to fund accounting so that the experience for the clients is top class. And finally, our in-house client service team works really hard to provide a seamless experience right from onboarding to their journey in terms of getting access to their portfolios and statements and so on. So as we help clients grow their wealth, we also don't want to take it for granted. Their trust in us, it is at most important, particularly while securing the financial future, that trust is intact, and we intend to work very hard to retain that. If you're interested in knowing more about our fund, feel free to reach out to us on our website.